This is the poet and the poem from the Library of Congress. I am Grace Cavalieri, and with me is the amazing artist who is changing the world with film, performance, and literature. Her name is Pamela Woolford. Hi, Pamela, to our little one-dimensional world.
Hello, Grace.
It's so great to see you. I want to take off all my clothes and be like you, but I might not.
I want to take all my clothes off and be more like me. So,
how could you be more like yourself? Pamela, you are everything. You are a documentarian. Tell me this. What is a multi-interdisciplinary artist? What is it that you are?
So I am an interdisciplinary artist, just as you said. And I think of myself as a narrative interdisciplinary artist. So I'm a writer, a filmmaker, an immersive media director. I'm also a performer. I predominantly perform in my own work.
When did you decide that there was more than one way to tell a story? That's really what I see in you. That at some point your thinking said, wait a minute, there's more than I can do more with these than I can do with language. What point changed your thinking?
Okay, so there's something very key in what you said that I didn't think, that you said, then I can do with language. And for me, it's all based on language. Language is the base for all of it. So it's that narrative aspect of my storytelling, and like I'm steeped in the literary arts. That's where I began.
You began as a writer, and then you saw that you could expand.
Yes. Yeah, my first real recognition as a writer, in terms of an honor, was that I received a Maryland State Arts Council award, an individual artist award, in the early 90s, and that was for a screenplay. And then it was some years later that I actually started directing scenes. And then that was my route to becoming a filmmaker.
Where did you get your courage, honey? Where do you get your courage? Were you born? I can just see you as a little girl. I can see how mischievous you were and how creative.
I don't know that I was mischievous, but maybe I'm not the person to ask. I was very confident, but I also felt like I was dropped in the middle of this this other world that people like I believed inside in my soul in myself. But I also really understood that there were other people who wouldn't always do that. we were speaking earlier about introversion. So not only am I an introvert, but at that time I was terribly shy. So the confidence was all, sort of bound up inside me.
I wonder what triggered it to come out. But we all know you're from the star planet. We all know you're from another galaxy. There's no question.
I don't even know what that means, but I'll tell you.
but you were born an artist. If ever I have met anyone who was willing to change the world by her own vision, it is Pamela Woolford. But starting out as a writer, let us know you as a writer and hear a little bit of that. And I'd like everyone to know that you were the author of more than 100 memoir, fiction, human interest, profile, interview, and think pieces published all over America. So we're now going to hear a little piece of your writing. Set it up for us, Pamela Woolford.
Okay, so at first I'll read from the piece that has opened at the Baltimore Museum of Art. And what I've done there is I've founded a new art form. It's called sound design photo narrations. And so what you'll see when you go to the exhibition, so I have a room there, it's called Antoine and Me. And they're like accompanying display cases with like historical documents and ephemera that relate to Black Baltimore through time. And I'm telling these narratives using two generations of my family who have their roots in Baltimore. And then the sound design photo narrations are STB narrations. So this series, it's called Antoine and Me, are a series of photographs taken of me where I'm in character. And then you put the headset on and you get a sound experience. It's so, And so I'll read from that sound experience.
Wow. When you're
there in person, there's much more to the sound experience. It's not just the narrative portion of it, but I will read a piece from there.
We'll take what we can get, Pamela.
Okay. I'm in the character of this woman, and she's in love with the photographer who's taking the photographs. In this photograph, I'm listening to him talk about us without talking about us. He talks, snaps photographs, same time. We had just finished what amounted to a heap of food, but it was nothing but juicy mangoes and toasted rolls with olives inside and sesame seeds on the outside and celery and fennel and chopped fine on a bed of one of those bitter lettuces I like and some watermelon after. And like always, he's always rambling about something he's read or what he thinks or what he's seen somewhere. And I know he's always talking about us when he tells these stories, giving me something to think about, but I don't give a hoot about it either way. But I listen. I don't even know if he knows he and I all he ever thinks about, which I don't mind. I like him the way he is. But right here, I'm waiting for him to be done, waiting my turn to speak, which I know will come, and I don't mind waiting. There's a baby pine bush behind me, and the breeze is wafting that butterscotch scent, and I keep reaching for the calm and luxury given by that scent in the wind. I'll wait. Antoine had taken the last roll and dipped it in the mango juice on my plate, sopping it up like a biscuit and gravy and eating while he talks. And I'm listening good. I can hear him chew and say his word. I'm waiting and living inside his mouth as he rambles on. That's what I'm doing here in this photograph.
Pamela Woolford, what a delicious human being you are indeed. And as a presenter and a performer, have you been an actor in other people's plays? Not really.
I've done voiceover work for a theater production. But I predominantly perform in my own work. I also have a background as a dancer. So I do movement-based art in some of my work as well.
You have occupied every dimension of the art world. So what is your life like? I mean, you must wake up in the morning and think, oh, I better write that script. I better get this takeover. I better make an appointment for a publication. Is that what your life is like?
Oh, you make it sound so much more fun.
No, when I think of you putting in that installation in Baltimore, I have to take three pills because of the technical that you have to engineer and be the director of, as well as the emotional, the sensual, the intuitive, the idea. Pamela, if you stopped to think what you did, you wouldn't be able to do it.
Well, it's too much. I feel like you said something very key there, because I do wear a lot of hats. I mean, part of that is because I don't have the money to not wear so many hats. But
you make a living as an artist. You're almost the only person I know who makes a living as an artist. And I'll tell you, that's bold.
Okay, so I'm going to correct you when you said something, because I will say this. I don't make a living as an artist. I work as an artist full time. But I am able to do that because my mother produces much of my work on her pension.
I work as an artist full time. That is the key sentence. It has nothing to do with a monetary award.
Right. And then I get what is considered really good money as an artist. I will win these grants that are like $10,000 here, $15,000 there. And most of that money goes back into the creation.
Oh, don't I know it.
And if you have a moment where, okay, well, I get to keep this $10,000, which never happens. but how much can you live off of $10,000? You know, so there's in the arts world, where when you're getting huge applause and what's considered big money is not a livable, sustainable wage. It's very difficult. And the thing that is so unfortunate for us as a society is that means that there's so many voices that are not heard because of that.
You have, say that again, Pamela. You have just hit the heart of the sadness in the artwork. Just say that one thing again.
There's so many voices that are not heard. That are lost to time.
Because they're working at Kinko's, Jiffy Lube, because one must make a job. Because they're working as teachers, educators, but they have given up the dream.
When you try, it is so difficult to work full time. It's some other occupation, whatever it is.
Of course.
And then to touch that part of yourself. Creative. And that.
Because it is all energy. Because that creativity inside of you is all energy. And when you have to dispatch that to a room full of kindergarten kids or a corporate room, when you come home, I know I work for PBS, and the only way I got through it was to do something for myself every morning before I work for anyone else, whether I wrote a poem or sent out an email. I just had to keep that spirit alive, because Pamela, you're just spirit in a human body. I mean, you're all spirit. And so, of course, but your energy, you have chosen to say, I'm going to live 100% on my artistic energy. Yeah. And that is my commitment and my declaration to the universe. And you wouldn't be happy doing anything else, Pamela.
Yes, that is very true. And I've tried.
And so there are so many people like that, that eke out their brilliance at the end of a tired day. But you said,
And I want to say this, there's so many Black people that are like that. And because I really have a primary concern for the Black voice, and its underrepresentation.
And that is what I wanted to get to. What is the story that you're telling again and again in different forms, Pamela Woolford? You're telling that story. That's the story.
So at the heart of much of what I do is my relationship with my mother, who still, as I said, that she produces much of my work. She's 86 years old, and she
must be magnificent.
She is. She's incredible. Like, she's just like,
But is she an artist? Would you call her an artist as well?
Most definitely. And she's also a multidisciplinary storyteller, because she's also a minister. She's a preacher. And she is also a literary artist, and then she also produces film.
I'm not surprised. It would take all of that to get a DNA in you.
I get my storyteller heart, honest, from her. And I think in many ways, I am often telling and retelling something about that relationship.
What do you think you're saying? Gratitude? Is it appreciation? Is it synchronization? What is that?
No. So when I was a small child, she would tell me stories about her life as a child growing up in the rural American South, in rural North Carolina, to be specific, because her heart is always in North Carolina.
Really?
The air is better there. The food is better there.
Really?
And it's a great migration story before we were talking about the Great Migration. And I was just fascinated by her telling me of this world that was so foreign to anything that I knew or experienced. And here was my own mother, and that was her life. And she grew up in a really, poverty-stricken environment, no paved roads, no running water, she was in this environment, had been just a few miles from it all of her life until she got on a bus and came to Baltimore. And it was an entirely different universe. And so in my mind, for my description, it's almost like being an alien, But it was the people in her stories, like that she would tell me about her neighbors and visiting them and her relationship with the church. I'm not religious, but in her.
But you're an angel, so you don't have to be.
So.
I'm getting it. She really made her life vivid and the characters, but if you were not an artist or a literary person, you wouldn't take to those characters and want to make them permanent. So the artist in you capitalized on her characters. And
there was
is that
also magical in the storytelling, because not only would she tell me those true life stories, she was at the same time, even she's telling me like the fairy tales and everything, you know, to your children. But for me, there was such magic in it because there was always a moral. And that one of the key things was that she never discussed them with me. But I always realized that if you think about it hard enough, there's always some gem and there's this takeaway. And that was part of it. And then
you
at some point,
finished her stories. You finish her stories. Would you say that?
No, because it's an interesting thing. So one of the pieces that I'll read from.
Okay, let's do it.
All right. So this
and set it up. Is this a description of what you're just telling us?
Yes. Okay. So this story, and I've said before, and I believe it's true that I was born to write this story, and it was heavily influenced by my hearing my mother's stories of her life growing up in rural North Carolina. This particular story is part of the basis for the script for my film Generation. It's an art film. It's an avant-garde film. But there's this double narration in it, and that it's based on the script. So, and I've decided, because it's the holidays, that I wanted to read this little excerpt from it that has to do with the holidays. So
let's hear it.
Okay. You know, we'd wake up, all of us, before dawn on Christmas, and we each have a stocking stuffed with tangy dried apple rings and sweet raisins on the vine that'd been dried on the smokehouse roof, and fresh walnuts in the shell and such. English walnuts that didn't turn your hands dark for weeks, like our own ones still in the hull, tasty as they were in autumn. And somehow, each of us would have a wrapped present from my parents from Santa, ball and jacks, Chinese marble checkers, a bingo or lotto set. Some years, when Grandma Nan had sold timber from her land, she would have for us something we had asked for. Maple got her dungarees from Grandma Nan one Christmas, and a tam. One year, I got a doll that looked just like a sleeping little baby. And once, there was a tea set. I love that little tea set. Made me feel grown and special, like it was real porcelain. Then after we'd opened everything and looked at it all and played, it'd be mid-morning and Mama would be baking apple jacks with the nutmeg, ginger, and cinnamon spice apple rings wrapped in her thin, flaky dough, sent in the house. And she would tell Mabel to go ahead and get us around to read from her book with the gift of the Magi Christmas story. Mabel would start to read in that voice of hers, all proper and low and soothing. I always remember how it opened, talking about that gray cat walking on a gray fence on a gray day. It all seeming sad for that woman who was thinking on how she didn't have a present for her husband. Then it was Christmas, the story said. Seemed like Christmas turned all that around. The husband and wife seemed like they just had each other, and in the end, that was enough. It made you feel sweet for them. Mama liked that it wasn't a grand story. It was about being happy, making do. Looked like they tried so hard, but it didn't matter in the end, Mama would say, and she'd kind of say it to me because I liked talking the story through. It wasn't just their presents they were happy on. It was each other, she'd say, and smile to herself, like she was hearing that story for the first time.
Ah, oh, Pamela, You're a one-woman show. You are. You should do a monologue on the stage. These are wonderful. These, you just transform yourself. When you start talking, you become something else. You really forget who you are. Now, I'm going to give you a quiz, and I'm going to ask you to answer one question. You're going to answer one thing about each of these. And these are your accomplishments. Okay.
Okay.
Art as a response to anti-Blackness. Tell us about that.
Oh, okay. So that was an incredible event. And I mean, it was a panel discussion.
Mm-hmm.
So when the pandemic came in 2020, I was had planned to have a public event at a gallery space. And one of the things that would be a part of it was the release of this short film called Interrupted.
Okay, I'm going to go to the next one because you have so many.
Ah, you're like that.
Wait, we have to cover all of these.
Okay.
20 years, 20 poets. What was that?
Okay, so that was a book that I edited with 20 incredible poets that came to my hometown and over a period of 20 years that were internationally known.
Every one of them is like a Pulitzer Prize winner. Okay, A World of Difference. What is that?
Oh, A World of Difference is a program that I did with Rita Dove and a young Black man, and I'm going to forget his name.
Joshua Coyne.
Thank you, Joshua Coyne. Yes. It was an incredible celebration. Mm. I mean, and it incorporated film and conversation and music, and it was like these two people discussing, you know, historic things. So
film scenes, on stage interviews, all inspired by 18th century Afro-Polish violinist. You have gone into the pockets and pulled out things we never heard of. What is Dominique Morisseau? Sunset Baby.
Oh, okay. So, I mean, she's a very well-noted playwright. And she came to, her work was performed in my hometown. And we partnered with Center Stage when Kwame Kwe Arma was the director over there.
Right.
So
right.
I worked with him, and we set up this program that both of the theater at Howard Community College and the Center Stage Theater were you know, working in real time virtually in a presentation that had to do with Dominique Morisseau's.
And as you said, your hometown is Columbia, Maryland. People do not know that.
I mean, my birth home is Baltimore, so I got to mix both in that.
You own Baltimore, you own Maryland, so just put that on the map.
I'm a Maryland.
You own Maryland, so how about Jambalaya Magazine?
Oh my God, so you're like really going
How
back
about to- Jambalaya, no, before that, the Jambalaya Fest.
Okay, the Maryland Jambalaya Fest happened at a lake out here in Howard County, Maryland. It was a celebration of the diversity of people of African descent in both in disciplines, and so like, we covered like business and entrepreneurship and the arts and you know, music and dance and
performance. Exhibitions from six museums.
Yes, oh, that was incredible. Oh. So there's six museams around the state. They brought pieces on site. There was an indoor portion and an outdoor portion, but the museum portion was outdoors. It was there was a pavilion in the outdoor section, and so it was I've never seen anything done like it before.
But you have done. We haven't seen anything like you before. How about Jambalaya Magazine? I remember that.
Oh, okay. So that was spotlighting people of African descent, and we had profiles and interviews and cooking pieces, and then at some point we developed a children's section as well. And I mean, it was this, you know, it was interesting because I did that when I was in my 20s. Like, you're going back through time, like things.
I want to just show everyone this.
Okay,
see these? These are like 10 pages of the things she's done. And look, and there's not a wrinkle on her. I'll tell you, what makes you run? What makes you go? I want some. What is it about you? You were just,
well, I mean, you're no small potatoes. Like you're the Energizer Bunny as well. So from yeah, one so energy to another.
Are you happy with your life, Pamela?
I'm terribly happy. I'm terribly fortunate. And at the center of nearly everything I do as an artist is my Blackness, and it's a celebration of that, and then it's a very communal feeling, and it's true in a lot of ways, and it's not just being Black, but also because a lot of my work is based in memoir, or even if it's fiction, it's a play on true life stories, and so something that's very important to me is my, like, not just my Blackness, and also but my womanhood, and now I'm in my mid-50s and being middle-aged, and sometimes that's not what you are constantly witnessing.
That's a beautiful way to put it. I bet that Lucille Clifton adored you, didn't she? And I bet that everyone loved you. Well, you know, Pamela, you are saying something which almost feels, well, it is very spiritual, actually, because it's holy work you're doing, because everything you create is in collaboration with the divine, because it didn't exist before and you're creating it. And that was what you were put on earth to do. And you're doing your job, girl. And you're hot, too. That doesn't hurt. So read us one last thing so we can just love you as much as possible.
I will read this piece. It's called The Pleasant People, and this is the opening to this story. And this is the very first piece of fiction that was published. And it's had many lives, and it's just this year been republished once again. You can find it online with a new
introduction. You know, I always tell my students, whatever you work for works for you later.
It
does. Never throw anything away, because it will be infused with new life. So yeah, let's hear your new life.
I'm a strong believer of that in many ways, not just the art. So this is the voice of this young girl, but I'm back there again. I'm in the house. It's warm, pleasant, the way I like it. I've just had that satisfying meal and I'm content because it's spring and I'm on break and I'm home. And then the scream, the shrill. I run to her. I just remember the running, which is odd because I couldn't have run more than a few paces before I reached the door. And that's where the memory stopped. But I'm not sure I see the point in pushing it. All of them seem to say the same thing, the counselors or therapists or whatever, that I should try. But I think there's a reason I don't remember what happened, and I'm not sure I want to know the reason. Even the police wished I could remember when they asked me about it that day. They kept asking, which doesn't make sense to me. They seem to know what happened. They were the ones telling me. And I don't doubt anything they said. I mean, it's not that I think they're trustworthy. It's just that it makes sense. What I would do, so I guess I did. They say I saw her lying there, or struggling, I guess, if she was still alive. That could be why I don't remember. That would be a morbid sight. But the doctor seemed to think she would have been dead before I got there, even if I ran quickly. He said it was almost instantaneous, which I'm glad of course. He said, gone, just like that. She would have been gone, just like that, he said. I remember thinking, what a funny way to put it. Gone. I felt removed from it all because I barely knew her. And when I think about it now, the way I felt just before everything changed, before the scream, I'm assuming so. What's the word? It's like a calm frequency. So carefree. It's like I was fun.
The voice of Pamela Woolford, and this is the Poet and the Poem from the Library of Congress. We wish to thank the Library of Congress for making the program possible. The series is produced by Forest Woods Media Production, post-production by Mike Turpin, MET Studios. Our funders are the Sinipet Fund, Natalie Canivore, and Sandy Jackson Cohen. Mike Turpin is our engineer, and I'm Grace Cavalieri.